Present today from our laboratory and from our school. The topic of today's seminar is about the Cretan Brain Bank, and I'm very happy that this is going to be a multidisciplinary presentation involving many different partners in this effort. The main presenter will be Manos Tavladorakis, who is a master student in our master program, and he's doing now his master thesis, and he's has done excellent work in the characterization of patients that have donated their brain to the Cretan Brain Bank. Apart from this, there will be a presentation from the different partners in this project, mainly and foremost from Mrs. Ioanna Kortzidaki, who is the chairwoman of the Allelegi Society of Heraklion, and has been the main driving force in the recruitment of patients and the informed consent process. Following that, Ms. Dr. Kragnoti, who is in the chief of the forensic department in the University Hospital, is going to present the way that the brain is taken from the patient. Following that, we'll have a presentation from Dr. Lapa from the pathology department in the medical school. And she will present the way that the sections are performed and the fixation and the storage of the tissues. And following that, we will have a presentation from the neuropharmacology department, Mrs. Karali. She's going to present the ways that these brains are used in favor of research. And in the end, we'll have the pleasure to meet Dr. Tsolaki from Thessaloniki, who is the main force behind the corresponding brain bank in Thessaloniki, and she's associating with our brain bank to present some aspects of the work being done in Thessaloniki too. So we will start with Manos. I welcome him, and he's going to present us the first aspects of this brain bank.
Okay, so Greetings, everyone. I'm very happy and glad to be here to be able to present you our work in progress regarding our project of establishment of the Cretan Brain Bank here in Crete. It's a multidisciplinary project in collaboration with ALLIGI, Association for Alzheimer Disease and Healthy Aging, Ms. Ioanna Korsidaki, Pizaki, Kolia, and Mr. Panagiotakis, with Hellas Neurobio, Pavin, is Solaki, and Mr. Anastakis, a group of bright researchers and scientists from Thalys Study, Multidisciplinary Network for Alzheimer's Disease Research, OENG, BASTA, CIMOS, and GONZAS. Of course, the Forensics Department, University Hospital of Heraklion, Ms. Kranioti will have some words later. Ms. Nathina, Ms. Hanaki, and Mr. Kodoyanis and Mr. Tzanakakis. Pathology Department here in Medicine School with Assistant Professor Anastasios Kutsopoulos, Eleni Lapa, and Eleni Lagudaki. The Neuroregenerative Pharmacology Lab here in Medicine School with Ioannis Haralabopoulos, Assistant Professor, and Kanelina Karali and Konstantina Hanmidou. And Neurology Lab with Ioannis Zaganas, Assistant Professor Ioannis Zaganas, Labros Mathiudakis, and myself. This is an overview of today's presentation. Mr. Zaganas told you the overview before. So let me begin with a question. Why should we establish a brain bank here in Crete? Well, first of all, we don't have any. But actually, as you probably know, the research on human brain diseases, so in Alzheimer, is currently conducted on cell cultures and animal models. So while we cannot deny their significant contribution to our general understanding of the disease, yet someone has to move into post-mortem brain tissue in order to fully elucidate the whole spectrum of disease mechanisms. For example, in Alzheimer's disease, 5xFAD mouse model, a great model, very often being recruited in terms of Alzheimer's disease research, it just exhibits only a beta pathology, and tauopathy remains elusive. And I repeat, it is a great model, but my point here is that sometimes we have to move a step back and examine the whole forest than each specific tree. So let's have a little history break here with Alcmaeon of Croton, who was the first to make an introduction to encephalocentrism, meaning that above all, what makes us humans is in the brain, either on heart or guts or whatever. And 2 centuries later, we have Aerophilus and Erasistratus, who were the first to make systematic human dissections. Actually, Aerophilus neuroanatomy is still in use and published today. And they distinguished nerves from blood vessels and tendons and spinal from cranial nerves. We have a medieval gap to reach 17th and 18th century, where when humanity got close to the perfection of preservation techniques, and we also had the rise of anatomy schools. Again, 2 centuries later, we get to the systemization of brain collections, and on that specific era comes Alois Alzheimer with August D to describe a peculiar cerebral disease, making some sketches of tangles and other accumulations. And just 50 years after Alois Alzheimer, we've got the first modern brain banks. And when I say modern brain banks, of course, there were brain collections before late 50s, early 60s, but those collections were for the scientific and economic elite. While in contrast, the modern brain banks are actively collecting and strategically preserving both a diseased brain and healthy brain, and they are distributing them around the scientific community. To reach 2021, we can count over 130 official brain banks around the globe. That brings us here, established in 2012. Our aim is to collect brains from dementia patients and controls, while in parallel, we collect pre-mortem serum and plasma in search of biomarkers and other genetic studies. a field actually open for collaborations. So the major goal is to facilitate research in Alzheimer's disease and other dementia. And I have to say here that this is in collaboration with Hellas Neurobio, the major Greek brain bank in Thessaloniki. So some rough demographics here. To date, we have 14 brains. Five of them are males, nine of them are females. And here you can see the number of brains obtained per year. So on our first steps, we had the rhythm of one brain per year, but later on things got a little sped up. But as Ms. Ioannis Kortsidakis will tell you, with coronavirus outbreak, things got a little bit slowed down. So what is the procedure behind the tissue collection? The public has to be informed, and that is happening thanks to Allelegee Association of Heraklion. And after information, we move to informed consent. And on that point, I'm glad to present you Ms. Ioannis Kortsidakis, chairwoman of Allelegee Association of Healthy Aging and Alzheimer's in Heraklion.
Με ιδιαίτερη χαρά, η μη κερδοσκοπική εταιρεία νόσου Αλτσχάιμερ και υγιούς γύρανσης νομού Ηρακλείου Αλληλεγγύη συμμετέχει στο πρώτο σεμινάριο Τράπεζας Εγκεφάλου Κρήτης με τη συνεργασία εκλεκτών επιστημόνων σήμερα 20 Μαΐου 2021 στο Ηράκλειο. Σε παγκόσμιο επίπεδο προσπάθεια έρευνας και μελέτης σε ό,τι αφορά την νόσο Αλτσχάιμερ και τα συνεφή νευροεκπαιδευτικά νοσήματα, η εταιρεία Αλληλεγγύη δραστηριοποιείται ενεργά προς αυτή την κατεύθυνση πάνω από μία δεκαετία. Κατόπιν ειδικής μελέτης και έγκριση ερευνητικού πρωτοκόλλου από το Επιστημονικό Συμβούλιο του Πανεπιστημιακού Γενικού Νοσοκομείου Ηρακλείου, λειτουργεί βιοτράπεζα εγκεφαλικού ιστού με τη συνεργασία της Νευρολογικής Κλινικής του Παγνή και συγκεκριμένα του επίκουρου καθηγητή νευρολογίας του Πανεπιστημίου Κρήτης και μέλος της Επιστημονικής Επιτροπής της Αλληλεγγύης κ. Ιωάννου Ζαγανά. Θα ήθελα να αναφερθώ εδώ στην κυρία Μάγδα Τσολάκη, την πρόεδρο της Ελληνικής Ομοσπονδίας για την νόσο Αλτσχάιμερ, η οποία μαζί με τον εξαίρετο συνεργάτη κ. Αναστάκη Δοξάκη ήταν αυτοί που μας ενέπνευσαν προς αυτή τη δραστηριότητα και τους ευχαριστούμε πολύ διότι από την αρχή μας κατεύθυναν, μας εμπιστεύτηκαν και μαζί πορευόμαστε προς ό,τι καλύτερο μπορούμε. Η επιλογή των ατόμων με άνοια νόσο Αλτσχάιμερ γίνεται μέσα από τα προγράμματα που πραγματοποιούνται στα κέντρα ημέρας της εταιρείας μας από τους εξειδικευμένους συνεργάτες μας, όπου προσέρχονται οι ασθενείς μας καθ' όλη τη διάρκεια της εβδομάδας για τις ασκήσεις νοητικής ενδυνάμωσης, προσοχής, μνήμης, λόγου κλπ. Η όλη προετοιμασία της δωρεάς ξεκινά από τους περιθάλποντες των ασθενών, τον υπεύθυνο της οικογένειας, οι οποίοι συμμετέχουν στις ομάδες ενημέρωσης, εκπαίδευσης και ψυχολογικής υποστήριξης μέσα από τα καθημερινά μας προγράμματα. Μέσα επίσης από μια σχέση εμπιστοσύνης, χρειάζεται να πιστούν για τη σοβαρότητα και κυρίως για την αξία της ενέργειας αυτής, ακόμα και σαν πράξη ευεργεσίας προς την ιατρική επιστήμη σε επίπεδο έρευνας για θεραπείας της νόσου. Πολλές είναι αλήθεια οι δυσκολίες που προκύπτουν και που αφορούν την ειδική αυτή προσέγγιση και προετοιμασία, αναφορικά με την ενημέρωση και την ευαισθητοποίηση των συγγενών των ασθενών, προκειμένου να δεχθούν να εξουσιοδοτήσουν την εταιρεία για τη μεταθανάτια χρήση του εγκέφαλου του ασθενούς με άνοια. Υπάρχουν περιπτώσεις που η οικογένεια δεν το συζητά καθόλου. Είναι αρνητική ευθύς εξ αρχής. Άλλοι έχουν ενδιασμούς για θρησκευτικούς λόγους. Φυσικά, αδικαιολόγητα. Προς τούτο, έχουμε ήδη πραγματοποιήσει ειδικό σεμινάριο με ιερείς της πόλης μας υπό την αιγίδα του Αρχιεπισκόπου Κρήτης, κ. Ειρηναίου, ο οποίος συμμετείχε προσωπικά. Κυρία Σολάκη, θυμόμαστε ότι είσαστε και εσείς ανάμεσά μας εκείνη την περίοδο, εκείνη την βραδιά. Πληροφορήθηκαν γενικά για την νόσο Αλτσχάιμερ, για την αλλαγή συμπεριφοράς των ασθενών της ασθένειας και τις ποικίλες συνέπειες στη ζωή τους, ούτως ώστε οι ιερείς, ενημερωμένοι πλέον, να είναι σε θέση να βοηθήσουν, να δώσουν οδηγίες, να συμβουλεύσουν ανάλογα τις οικογένειες των πασχόντων όταν αυτές ζητήσουν τη βοήθειά τους. Στο θέμα δωρεάς εγκεφάλου, η γνώμη τους είναι καθοριστική. Χωρίς γραπτή έγκριση δεν είναι δυνατόν καμία παρέμβαση. Γενικά, η σχετική ενημέρωση του κοινού είναι απαραίτητη ακριβώς επειδή είναι καθοριστική. Προς τούτο, προγραμματίζουμε σχετικά σεμινάρια εκπαιδευτικά για περιθάλποντες και συγγενείς ασθενών με άνοια, ώστε να γίνει κατανοητή η σκοπιμότητα και η πραγματική αξία της δωρεάς εγκεφάλου. Με τις ενέργειες αυτές ενισχύεται η ελπίδα και η πίστη για την επιστημονική κατανόηση όλων των σχετικών νευρολογικών νοσημάτων. Γι' αυτό και αξίζει, όπως πιστεύουμε, την προσπάθεια όλων μας. Ευχαριστώ.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Anna. And, upon information and informed consent, as we said earlier, we collect pre-mortem serum plasma, serum and plasma from the donors, and then we have tissue collection in collaboration with forensics department, University Hospital of Heraklion. And I'm glad to present you on this point, Ms. Elena Hraniotti, to elaborate a bit more on that topic.
Good evening, everyone. I'm very excited to be part of this project, as I think that is really important to enhance the creation of tissue banks in Greece. And actually, this is the second initiation that our department participates. I would like to give you an overview of what we do and who we are. Forensic Medicine Unit is a part of the University Hospital, General University Hospital Heraklion. And it was created in 1988 by Professor Manolis Michalodimitrakis. It's one of the two forensic services in Crete. And what we actually do is we do dissections, we do autopsies of forensic cases, that is violent deaths that the authorities ask us to, or any sudden death that the family has inquiry to find out why death occurred in their beloved ones. We operate in Eastern Crete, that is the prefectures of Lasithia and Heraklion, and our department handles about 300 cases per year. Can we go to the next slide, please? As I said, we're based in the University General Hospital Heraklion. You can see a little photo of our morgue on the right side. The department is not very big, but it actually, it suits the needs of the island for the two prefectures I mentioned before. We have two autopsy tables, one embalming table, that is a place where we prepare the body if there is a need to travel somewhere else so that we can reduce the decomposition rates. We have 11 cold deep freezer chambers and sample deep freeze storage for any tissue that we need to retain for our own histological examinations. The department, apart from myself, has another three forensic pathologists, so we are four in total. Two forensic technicians that they help us with all the tissue extraction and body fluid sampling during the autopsy. And an histopathology technician that prepares the tissues for us to look under the microscope. There are several research students, two PhD students, a couple of MSc students, and some undergraduate students that are quite interested in what we do. Our recent interests vary, and actually the most important ones of this period has to do with postmortem imaging. We are the first center in Greece that applies postmortem imaging in the forensic cases. We're very interested in histopathology. We do experimental ballistics. We are interested in bone biomechanics. Methods of identification in unidentified individuals, especially in the context of migration crisis. The cardiovascular disease and sudden juvenile death, that is the second project where we participate in terms of sampling tissue for genetic testing. And of course, we're very, very interested in the creation of the brain bank in Crete. Now, what we do in this group is actually we receive the body after the family has consented to give the brain. And we do the same procedure as we do when we have an autopsy case. So there's a careful dissection of the tissue from the left to the right mastoid. We remove the part of the scalp and we take out, actually cut, dissect part of the skull because we need a very good opening in order to remove the brain intact. Then we remove the brain and following the CB protocol that Manos will come back to you later with that, we're doing dissections of the samples that are necessary for the project. It is very important to note that the brain is not fixed at that stage. So it requires special attention to do a proper dissection of the anatomical regions that are required for the project. So after the sampling is done and the samples are taken by Manos for further testing, our technicians are also doing the preparation of the body that needs to be in a proper state to be released to the family for the burial. As I said, we are very, very proud to be part of this project, and we are thanking the group for giving us the opportunity to participate in the CBD project. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you, Ms. Craniotti. And let us move on from the point of having the brain. And receiving the brain, it is divided in two hemispheres. Hemisphere B is stored at minus 80 degrees and is utilized for protein, RNA, and DNA studies. And hemisphere A is hemmed in formalin and is utilized for immunohistochemistry studies. As we said earlier, in parallel, serum and plasma are collected in terms of biomarker and genetic studies. So let me introduce you, Eleni Lapa, to elaborate more on in regards with hemisphere A.
Good evening, dear colleagues. My name is Eleni Lapa and I am a pathology consultant. I represent the pathology department under the supervision and guidance of Professor Anastasios Koutsopoulos. I will tell you a few things about the role of the pathology department in the research project. The neuropathology diagnostic examination entails specific working steps. Everything starts with the tissue. First, we receive the selected formalin fixed brain hemisphere and we proceed with a macroscopic evaluation and the transversal to the longitudinal axis dissection, as you can see in the photos. 17 specific anatomical sites of the brain hemisphere are selected and put in blocks, which are then embedded in paraffin. I will elaborate further on the selected sites in the next slide. Paraffin sections from tissue are first cut and stained with amatoxylin and eosin. Additional sections from tissue are used for immunohistochemical staining, for example, tau, beta amyloid, etc. Then we proceed with the assessment of the staining results, staining quality, stained cells, regions of interest in the slide. The neuropathologically characterized brains provide a solid basis for further research. Unstained sections are then stored for further use as well as blocks. As pathologists, we guarantee and ensure data security, patient privacy, research consent, and tissue preservation. This is a table from the 2018 article of Irina Lafuzov. Since 1990, the neuropathologists know the protein alteration in neurodegenerative diseases progress in a neuroanatomically specific manner. There is an initiation site and a presumed pattern of progression to other brain sections. In this slide, you can see the selected areas. The staining is performed in consecutive order, starting with the initiation site given as one. The assessment of the staining yields a stage phase of altered protein, for example, Bragg stage. As you can see, we select the regions that are presumed to be the last affected and assess the staining pattern of different antibodies. Manolis will show you examples and photos of this later in his presentation. There are different methods and diagnostic tools which can be used for research and discovery. Tissue macroarray block construction and sectioning gives us many advantages. Blocks with cores from multiple brains, serial sections, different antibodies, lower cost to name a few. Microdissection, the precise single cell isolation, where we can choose specific cell types, neurons, for example, or specifically stem cells, tau negative, tau positive, etc. With the help of NTS, we can explore the genetic profile. Digital pathology and whole slide imaging as another emerging essential component of our work gives us advantages, for example, the possibility of precise quantification of stem cells. It can also help us move our work beyond our laboratories and healthcare organizations. As we can all understand, modern technology application provides us with enormous amount of data. This is where artificial intelligence can help us with complex diagnostic tasks, storage and statistics, etc. We are open to new ideas and suggestions. And with that, I thank you very much. And we return to the presentation of Manolis Tavladorakis.
Thank you, Eleni. So some initial results here. To date, 7 out of 14 brains are histopathologically characterized as HIAAD brains, meaning that we have indeed found amyloid accumulations and hyperphosphorylated tau accumulations. Brief comment here, in Alzheimer's disease, amyloid and tau accumulations are two major histopathological, neuropathological hallmark of the disease. So as Eleni told you earlier, we have found on the last presumed site to found its protein, meaning that we have found accumulations of amyloid in the dentate nucleus and accumulations of hyperphosphorylated tau on occipital lobe. There are some representative figures. First, regarding amyloid plaques, one can observe a gamma spectrum of neuropathological hallmarks. For example, perivascular amyloid accumulations, diffuse plaques, and dense core plaques. We use 116 antibody. And regarding hyperphosphorylated tau, again, one can observe from the classic flame-shaped tangles to ghost extracellular tau accumulations, neuropil threads, and tau crown formations. So to move to our future aspects and steps, you should know that we are very interested in glutamate dehydrogenase. And it's an enzyme that catalyzes the reversible deamination of glutamate to ketoglutarate. And it is used in order to fuel aerobic metabolism through Krebs cycle. And as you can guess, in neurotransmitter recycling. Also, it regulates autophagy and insulin secretion. Humans have two isoforms, very homologous one to other. The second, GDH2, emerged from the ancestral GDH1 through retrotransposition and mutations. And that evolutionary adaptation came in parallel with the prefrontal, with the enlargement of the prefrontal cortex. You should also know that GDH1 is a housekeeping protein expressed constantly in all human tissues, while in contrast, GDH2 has a differential expression pattern, mostly expressed in brain, testes, and kidney. Also, GDH2 is resistant to GTP inhibition in contrast to with GDH1. On our laboratory, we're very happy and lucky to have the crystal structure of GDH2 solved and to also have developed specific antibodies for GDH2, because as we said earlier, they are very homologous one to other. So with a specific antibody for GDH2, having raised on our laboratory, we can detect just the second isoform and not GDH1, in contrast, of course, with other non-discriminating antibodies. As you can see here, GDH2 can be detected in all cortices of human brain. We're also very interested in localization of those enzymes. For example, the work of Labros Methiodakis showed that they tend to co-localize when contrasfected with different fluorescent fusion proteins. They tend to co-localize near nearby into the cell. And why do I speak so much about the GDH? It is found that the GDH1 expression is closely related to memory function. So in contrast with what was mentioned earlier, that it is a housekeeping gene, in terms of memory function, its expression is upregulated. Moreover, mice that overexpress GDH1 are found to have increased levels of glutamate, and on hippocampal areas like CA1, one can observe a reduction of dendritic spines and axonal nerve terminals, and acceleration of age-related neuronal loss in a pattern similar to the disease, to the Alzheimer's disease brain. Moreover, again, in contrast with the previous statement, Burbaeva et al. On 2005 found in Alzheimer's disease patients increased levels of GDH1, meaning that GDH1 is related for the related with a good memory function and also related with Alzheimer's disease brain. Moreover, regarding our work, Christina Dimovasili, a work in preparation, found on a large cohort, Cretan cohort, around 600 subjects, found a specific polymorphism of GDH2 gene sharing 498 to alanine, where no males with that specific polymorphism were found having dementia, meaning that that specific polymorphism is somehow protective mostly for males, while also females have lower dementia rates. This is a validation for the cohort with APOE4 allele, meaning that 25% of the subjects were heterologous to APOE allele, and they were having a head dementia. There are many more works regarding GDH2. Most of them are in terms of disrupted homeostatic mechanisms of glutamate metabolism. And there is actually an hypothesis of astrogliosis, which is a major histopathological hallmark in AD. It is hypothesized by Osborne that could be a protective mechanism to excitotoxicity from glutamate, meaning that in Alzheimer's disease you have excitatory neurons that fire rapidly, and that excess of glutamate on the synapses makes the brain a homeostatic mechanism to recruit astrocytes to remove that excess of glutamate. So finally, about our next steps, of course we want to complete the histopathological characterization of the rest of the seven brains, SAD or not. We also want to quantify the protein levels of GDH enzymes and their enzymatic activity, because we may find similar protein levels, but their enzymatic activity could differ, be lower or higher. We also want to study the localization of those enzymes in the AD brain, works that have not been done until now in the literature. Finally, as Eleni told you before, Eleni Lapa, with the help of microdissection techniques, we want to distinguish specific cell types, for example, tau positive neurons and tau negative neurons, and have some protein analysis there, or microglia and astrocytes localized near plaques, and those that are not localized near plaques, and have some protein analysis there. And with that words, I present you Kanelina Karali, a great colleague, to continue with the future steps of the project.
So hello to all, I'm Kanelina Karali, and I'm a postdoc in the Neurogenetic Pharmacology Lab. And I will discuss our involvement in the Cretan Brain Bank project. The main interest of our lab is the neurotrophins such as NGF and BDNF, which bind to the TRK and TRKB receptors respectively, as well as the P75 NTR receptor. And in this way, they control processes such as survival, proliferation, differentiation, axonal growth, synaptic formation, CNS homeostasis. Interestingly, beta amyloid, a hallmark of AD, binds to the P75 NTR receptor, leading to cell death. So the neurotrophins and the receptor have been strongly linked with the development of Alzheimer's disease within the concept of a widespread neurotrophic dysregulation with a neuroprotective pro-neurotrophin, with the neuroprotective neurotrophins being downregulated, whereas the damaging pro-neurotrophin being upregulated, and this event together with insulting events as amyloid toxicity, excitotoxicity, and neuroinflammation result in deleterious signaling that alter the synaptic function, decrease the neurite integrity, lead to demyelination and decrease survival of cells, and finally result in cognitive dysfunction. Our work so far has been focused in animal models of AD, in particular the 5X fat mouse model. And in our lab, we have developed a synthetic neurotrophin, the BNN27 neurotrophin, which is patented by Nature FTD. And when the 5X fat mice are given BNN27, they show improvement in cognitive performance. They have decreased formation of amyloid plaques within the hippocampus, and also they have increased proliferation and generation of new neurons in the dentate gyrus of the hippocampus. Another interest of our lab is the myelin and white matter and particularly in AD, there is widespread myelin loss in various areas, which also precedes amyloid and tau pathology. There are also reduced protein levels, myelin-related proteins, and these hypomyelinated axon are more vulnerable to oxidative stress and A-beta toxicity. So we question whether this myelin damage is a secondary result of AD or the oligodendrocytes exhibit internal deficits that contribute to AD pathology. So we went back to our animal model and we firstly checked the oligodendrocyte progenitor cells in the brain of a one-year-old mouse and of one-year-old mice. And we saw that there is significant reduction in the number of oligodendrocyte progenitors within the hippocampus. However, the main questions we want to investigate is firstly, check the expression profile of neurotrophin receptors and the P75 receptor. And here is a first image of P75 receptor in a patient, in an AD patient from the Cretan Brain Bank, and also investigate a possible interaction between P75 expression and A-beta or tau tangle load, and also in respect with astrogliosis and microgliosis. And here you can see IBA1, which stands for microglia, and GFAP, which stands for astrocytes in a patient from the Cretan Brain Bank. And also we want to investigate changes in OPC number or myelinating oligodendrocytes, whether the myelin loss or interacts with the amyloid load, and also analyze phosphotau deposit in the OPCs and mature oligodendrocytes. However, the aspiring step forward for the Cretan Brain Bank is the creation of a brain cell bank from the patients recruited by allelegee, where with a simple skin biopsy or blood collection, we will be able to generate human iPSCs, induced pluripotent stem cells, from real AD patients, from actual AD patients, as well as healthy individuals. And in this way, we will be able to investigate Alzheimer's disease-related abnormalities in oligodendrogenesis or neurogenesis, alterations in neurotrophic signaling from iPSCs-derived oligodendrocytes, neuron or astrocytes. And also from the cells of actual patients, we will be able to do compound screening and to in an effort to identify novel agents that may reverse the pathogenic phenotype of AD. And now I give you back to Manos for the closing remark. Thank you.
Okay, great. Just a brief comment here that all this project, all this work could not be done without the collaboration of great partners, but also could not be done without the collaboration of the patients and the relatives, on whom we are very thankful for. And that's all. Thank you very much.
So thank you, Manos, and all the other collaborators for these presentations. Finally, I would like to invite Mrs. Tsolaki to present also some facts about our collaboration with the Brain Bank in Thessaloniki.
I would like to thank Professor Zaganas for this kind invitation. I'm very happy to be with you today, tonight, this afternoon, because I saw that a small candle from Thessaloniki became a fire which started from Greece. And I'm very happy for this. So the name of our organism is Pan-Hellenic Biobank, and I want to start with some words about the history. It was founded officially in Thessaloniki, 20 November 2013. A chair of this organization is the neuropathologist Dr. Anastakis Doxakis. However, we had many brains, CSF and blood samples selected before. The first brain was logopenic PPA, primary progressive aphasia brain, in 1995. Half of these traveled to Chicago to Professor Meshulam, who approved the diagnosis of PPA. So now we have formerly 83 brains in Thessaloniki, 30 in Alexandroupolis, 1 in Athens, and 14 in Crete. 5 half brains in Thessaloniki and 5 half brains in Crete, as far as I know, are kept in minus 80 caesium, and 50 of them were examined until now, some of them completely and some of them partially. We have 15 informed consents for future brain donation, and except brains, we have also all this biological material, and with CSF, we sent this sample in some universities with which we collaborate, and some we analyze because we have organized the laboratory under the umbrella of the University of Thessaloniki in Quebec. The same we do with plasma, serum, saliva. We didn't until now examine urine samples, but there is another laboratory in the same university which we is going to Professor Feveridis, who is going to analyze also these samples. We have about 500 DNA samples, and we have analyzed about 5,525 APOE. We have published two studies with these samples. We have 2010 EG, and in our database, Bevotris, we have about 16,000 patients with demographics and risk factors and neuropsychological examination. And also we have other 6,000 in SPCSS problems. So this is the informed consent we use and we give to our donors, and we give this information in order to come, if they want to come in contact and have more information. Every person more than 18 years old can complete this informed consent. And also there is another informed consent from caregiver, which is completed by the caregiver if the patient is in the moderate or severe stages of the disease, and he cannot sign this informed consent. So we have this leaflet, which is this the first page, this is the last page. Inside there are the informed consents, the both informed consents, which is given to everybody who wants to participate in this big effort. But also there is another informed consent for all the other material, biological material we have collected in our biological bank. Thank you very much for your attention.
So we would like to thank Dr. Tsourlaki for all the initiation of this effort, and I'm very happy that we see these results. So as you saw, the whole story behind the Cretan Brain Bank and the corresponding bank in Thessaloniki is based on an effort from multiple partners, and we saw how we start from the from obtaining formal informed consent from the patients and or caregivers to the to obtaining the brain, and then performing the proper dissections and the formal characterization according to specific criteria that this is an AD patient, then going forward to studies that concern either immunocytochemistry with sections of the brain, or other studies like protein or enzymatic or RNA or DNA studies in this hemisphere. And this shows us that the effort from the people to that obtain informed consent, but also the donation from the patients and their family is not going in vain, but is going to move us forward in the in studying the pathophysiology of Alzheimer's disease, but of course and other types of dementia, and hopefully in the future this will give us an idea how to prevent or treat the disease. So thank you everybody for the participation, and I think we are open for discussion now because we don't have so much time for questions. Or comments also are accepted. Questions, suggestions?
Yeah, may I ask something, Yanni and Mark? Well, I think it's an impressive effort, and as you said, it takes years and years to coordinate, and I congratulate you for all this. And unfortunately, we haven't been able to do something like this in Athens. I wish we had a neuropathologist or somebody who would be interested. So one thing I want to ask is if you ask your neuropathologist for connection or for connections, I mean, within their field of people or people who would be interested to do it in Athens, would be helped to, you know, to build something similar to what you have done here. The thing I wanted to ask is, have you combined your data? You have numbers because we have like 80 something brains in terms of how many are have Alzheimer's disease, how many do not have Alzheimer's pathology.
I think, Nikos, the main problem is that we have not much money in order to buy all these kits we need in order to examine all these brains. So we try to find money in order to examine all these faces, all these brains first. But it is difficult to find money for this purpose. We can find money from social projects, we can take projects, Erasmus projects, we can take IMI projects, GTAD in the past for other studies, but for brains, we couldn't succeed to be connected with other laboratories in Europe in order to succeed the common common applications for finding funding. So this is what we didn't succeed as
well. Let me understand. So the neuropathology departments in the university, they don't have money for, I don't know, alpha-synuclein or amyloid stains. That's the major limitation.
The same problem is in Athens also.
Yeah.
I have discussed many times with Tara, who is the chair of forensic department.
Yeah.
They have no money to work on this.
So let me understand. I'm not arguing with you. I just want to understand what's the problem. So if they receive the money in the pathology department, a brain in the pathology department, and they want to find out whether that brain has Alzheimer's pathology, they don't have silver staining? They don't have alpha-synuclein staining?
The only thing they can do easily is hematoxylin and
therosin. Okay.
So just to say something, that was our main thought. If you have the brains, you need to characterize them as much as you can in the best way. So this, as Manu showed before, this was our first goal, and that's why we bought the antibodies in collaboration with Dr. Kalabopoulos and Dr. Kouchopoulos. And the first step, as you saw, for these seven brains was to characterize the brain as far as beta amyloid and tau staining is concerned. So these seven brains that Manos presented are fully characterized, and they fulfill all the criteria for Alzheimer's disease pathology. It was a table that showed that we perform staining for beta amyloid and tau in different areas like hippocampus, occipital lobe, even the cerebellum. And so we know for these seven patients that they are Alzheimer's disease patients, definite. And then from there, we started to do any other studies. So the first thing, as Nico said, is to fully characterize the brain, and then to start, you know.
What's the cost? Can you give us an average cost, or maybe the neuropathologist, what's the cost per brain to characterize it in terms of Alzheimer's or neurodegenerative pathologies? Is it, how much is this? Is it like, so 100,000 euros, or is it
no,
100 euros?
No, yeah, for example, is for the antibody we bought about for tau, it was about, man, I think 800 euros, something like that, and you can use it in multiple brains. But then you need, of course, a kit for staining, and then I don't know if Dr. Kouchopoulos or Elena can elaborate on this. Dr. Lapa can elaborate on the cost. It's not prohibitive. I mean, and you go nowhere if you don't characterize the brain properly. So if you don't know that there's Alzheimer's pathology, you cannot perform any other studies and go to, let's say, dissect single cells and then perform single cell analysis, etc. Don't know, Elena, if you have about the cost, but it's not prohibitive. I would say that since you can use the antibodies for multiple brains, it's not prohibitive.
I'm not sure about the cost of the antibodies, and unfortunately, Professor Kouchopoulos is not here with us because he had to be present in another webinar at the same time. Of course, we can do the preliminary staining with hematoxylin and eosin, and after that, perform staining with tau for tau or beta amyloid. And this we could do that for multiple brains, and we could also use that for different uses, for example, microdissection, etc. So it's not only for one or two. We can use it in multiple brains.
So,
but I'm not sure. I'm not sure about the cost. I don't know nothing about the cost. Sorry.
So it's about. I think 100 or 150 euros if you divide by the total.
Oh, much less.
It's around 1500 euros per 500 sections. Mm-hmm. So each brain has around 20 sections, let's yeah. say, to stain all over the different regions. The cost is, we have to do the maths, but it's around like to buy two antibodies and the kit for the development of the stain, it's around 1500 euros for 500 sections, something like this.
Yannick, could I ask a question?
Mm-hmm. Yes, of course. I thought you were going to offer the money.
Well, I haven't said no yet.
That's why they're not giving the exact estimate, Costa. They want you to commit first and then give you the number.
Okay.
Yeah, exactly. So
we will name it Liketsos Brain Bank.
Yes.
Because if we would like to say that examining brains, we have also to use TDP43 protein antibodies, we have to use synuclein antibodies, not only beta amyloid and tau protein. The brain of a neurodegenerative disease is a mixed pathology. So the cost for amyloid beta is about 900 euros. And the cost of tau protein is 900 euros, but also all the other proteins we have to examine in order to say with the probability that this brain is Alzheimer's disease or it's a mixed pathology. Otherwise, we do mistakes in other examinations or in other studies, biochemical studies. So this is the cost. This is why we say that the cost is very high, is too high for us.
So if I could, first of all, no doubt, wonderful work. It's really terrific to see the effort get off the ground. It's good to see two centers collaborating, maybe getting another center going. It truly is. I'm a big believer in the view that if you do exciting science, the money will follow. So I don't see the exciting science here. I mean, it's a wonderful effort. It's really terrific. But what are you doing that isn't being done in 200 laboratories around the world? That's point number one, question number one. The second question is, how are you characterizing and defining control brains? Because it seems like your major focus is on people with Alzheimer's disease. But really, it's the control brains, the people who clinically die normal, that are the most exciting findings. So certainly at Hopkins, we've accrued several hundred brains of people who die normal cognitively and clinically, but have full AD pathology. So just wanted to kind of put out there, obviously I'm being devil's advocate. I'm not trying to discourage you. But I think the way to make this really exciting is to think of what is the exciting science that you can do. And part of it is to start thinking of how do you relate this clinically when you've got a lot of pathology but a normal clinical state. That's where the future is, as opposed to just looking at brains of people that everybody else is doing.
Okay, so I don't know if Dr. Haralambopoulos, Yannis, want to answer about the second part of the... So what's the exciting science that you can base on a properly characterized brain? And what's the advantage of the brain bank?
This is Akume.
Yanni, you need to open the microphone.
Sorry. Yes, actually, first of all, we had Dr. Kessou had also the same demand actually from Yannis. We demanded some control brains, either young brains to have a fine, healthy tissue, but also normal age brains in order to compare with all the findings that we get in the pathology of AD patients. So we're looking now for some quite good controls.
The brain bank and the consent has been obtained from normal individuals through the process that we described before. But unfortunately, we have not been able to obtain a control brain. But we have obtained informed consent from healthy aged adults. And so we think that soon, hopefully for us, but I mean, unfortunately for the people, is going to produce control blades, because I agree that your controls validate your experiments. So in the past, we have obtained some control blades, but you know, from other much younger patients. So the proper control would be age matched with this. Okay, sorry, Ioannis, for the just to, to add. And the second.
Okay.
We have
well.
Them in healthy days, you can send them to you. We have healthy brains from
young. Yes, like to have. Okay.
So if you yes. want some, you can send them to you.
Okay. That's great. That's great. Okay. So about your second question, which indeed is the most interesting. For our laboratory, actually, the interesting case here is to co-stain, to co-detect, or even better, to find differences in the molecules that we are interested in, the neurotrophic receptor, the signaling pathways, the stemness or the non-stem cell markers that co-stain with tau or alpha beta, or they are co-expressed in the same cells. Is there a difference between neuronal and glial cells according to neurotrophic receptor expression and tau expression, for example? Questions like this. And we can do this only in a single cell level, actually. So we need the human brain, of course, fully characterized as an AD brain, because this is the first step that you have to do. And then to find some interesting, as you said, differences that differentiate one AD patient from the other with the same clinical image, more or less. And the more valued interest that we have is now to start isolate cells, actually, because we invest more in human brain cell bank. We try to isolate blood cells or fibroblasts from derma biopsies and start creating, in parallel with Yanni's observation on the patient, on the human patient, to start having also some cell samples from these patients that will induce, that will reprogram to IPS, and we will have also the IPS-derived cell bank. And through time, to do experiments in IPS of these patients with or without drugs, and on parallel to see the clinical image of these people, and finally, to have the brain of these people. So to compare through all stages, later on, or on the early disease, on sporadic forms, or in genetic variations that we have in Crete, to compare the cell phenotype with the actual phenotype of the patient. This is actually what we have in mind.
So to summarize is that about exciting science, we don't have only one exciting scientific question. We have maybe 1,000 scientific questions that you know originate from different observations. I'm sure that all the basic scientists or the clinical scientists here, they have some question they want to ask in a properly characterized brain. So if we have like a 1,000 exciting sciences, then we can have 1,000 exciting grants. I don't know if we answered your question.
You did. It's a great vision. It's a vision. And so it'd be a very interesting to start getting into the discussion. I guess part of my point, which I'll be making a little bit more explicit, is it's really important to move away from doing stuff that everybody else is doing and start thinking of stuff that's very unique, because many people elsewhere are doing a lot of what you're doing with more resources, greater capacity to do things. So rather than being lions, you need to be foxes. You need to be thinking of what are the opportunities that are unique to your cohort, that are unique to your laboratories. So I'm really encouraging you to keep going and to start getting very concrete along those lines. I'm still seeing general stuff. Again, want to encourage, not discourage. This is absolutely fabulous, but you need to be building in exciting science that are unique to what you can do and what your cohorts can show.
You're absolutely right about the uniqueness of the question that we must put. And on that thought, I would say that, for example, the idea that we had behind all this collaboration with Ioannis and getting involved in AD field is actually to test drugs that we have produced and patented, and they are actually unique. We have done studies only in mice till now, and we have very promising results, but as you know better than me, perhaps, we have to get test these drugs also in human cells, human brains, human patients, perhaps in the future. But we have to test them in human material, for sure.
I think that's a great direction. And I do know a lot about your molecules from previous visits. So I think that would be a terrific direction. So maybe think of ways to get there quickly.
Yes. You're right.
Okay. So the first excitement was, you know, the first time that Manos and the other people stained for tau, and we have bought this expensive antibody, as Nico said, and we saw the staining of tau, and we said after so many years of collecting the brains, we could see, and staining and doing all this, we could see light. And that was a real excitement, an excitement that you cannot buy with money. So, are there any other questions? Ms. Matt, Dr. Mata wants to.
So, I think that you're collecting very valuable sort of tissue and material. The thing is, as Costa said, to look for things that other people haven't been looking for. So do you intend, for example, to look at inflammation, at astrocytes? Because for neurons, it's the end point. There is degeneration. And have you seen the degeneration, actually? I mean, have you seen the plaques? Have you in these brains? So that's great. But I mean, a much sort of emerging question, I think, is the glial cells. Sort of microglia, astroglia, and oligodendrocytes, as Ioannis has been looking for. Regarding the single cell RNA-seq, I think you mentioned Ioannis, it would be interesting to compare, because I think it has been done already. Yes. So,
of course.
You know, because this is very, quite an elaborate technique, especially yes. for the human brain, you know, too many cells to sequence eventually. So to compare what has already been sort of done already will be very, very helpful. And I think we would be interested also to compare, you know, characteristics between Parkinson's disease and Alzheimer's disease, to find sort of common pathways, perhaps, both cellular and molecular. So yes, I think it's an extremely good start and invaluable material, so that somebody can go from the mouse, the animal, or the iPS cells back and verify the phenotypes in the human brain. It would have been great to have sort of earlier brains, but I guess that's not possible also. the big question is what initiates all these diseases. And this is sort of, I think, a very, very exciting point to look at.
Thank you. So thank you for these very helpful comments. Canelina showed some staining from microglia and astrocytes in her presentation from these brains. So I think we are running out, or have run out of time. I don't know if there is any more questions, or we should close and give the floor to the digital floor to Vaso to conclude.
To me?
Yes, you are.
Now, I wanted also to say a final, first of all, I want to thank all the speakers for the excellent presentations, extremely informative, and it's very good for everyone, both basic scientists and clinicians, people that they are working not only in Alzheimer's disease, but also in other neurodegenerative diseases. to hear and to learn these valuable sources. And I wanted also to make a small question. I wanted to or a note, maybe also it would be very interesting to start collecting also blood from the same, before, of course, from the same individual so that you can do some biomarker correlation between blood and brains. And that was my final note. And yes, I don't have anything else to say. Thank you so much for what you're doing and for participating in the HIAAD initiative. Okay.
Thank you. Actually, we have been collecting all these years serum and plasma and whole blood from these patients. And so we have available and sometimes serially. So these are materials are available, and this is the ultimate goal, and even IPS in the future, to have the serum and the plasma in different time periods, and then have finally the brain and can compare. So we have been doing that.
Yeah, that's extremely exciting. Thank you very much, everyone.
Thank you.
So thank you.
Have a good evening, everybody.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.